Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nos programas offrent plusieurs langues. Veuillez visiter suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Nuestros programas ofrecen varios idiomas. Visite suprememastertv.com/schedule.
Τα προγράμματά μας προσφέρονται σε πολλές γλώσσες. Παρακαλούμε δείτε suprememastertv.com/schedule.
The works of God being most perfect, admitting no addition or deduction, must remain the same forever. It is impossible that anything should exist that could cause a change in them.
Please continue watching for the wisdom of medieval Jewish philosopher and rabbi Moses Maimonides, vegetarian.
If you get the chance to visit gorgeous Russia, you will hear the welcoming "Как поживаете?", which means "How are you?" in Russian. Peaceful viewers, I am Dmitry. The altruistic Russian people wish for you to thrive in blissful harmony in heaven's radiance. Welcome to the eternity of the universe. From The Guide for the Perplexed by Maimonides, Vegetarian, Part 2 of 2, on Words of Wisdom. Maimonides, also known as Harambam or Rabbi Moses ben Maimon, was a notable medieval Jewish philosopher, astronomer, physician, and intellectual figure. Born into a prominent family in Spain, Maimonides' path eventually led him to Morocco and Palestine, until he finally settled down in Egypt, in Al-Fostat, near Cairo. Shortly after moving to Egypt, life-changing events urged him to start his practice as a physician. Having a background of medical studies, it was not long before Maimonides became renowned in the area and became the personal physician to the Sultan Saladin, a famous Muslim military leader. His schedule also included tending to other patients, lecturing before fellow physicians, and after becoming a leader of the Jewish community, teaching and helping its members. Famous works by Maimonides include Mishneh Torah, a commentary on the Talmud, and the Guide for the Perplexed, philosophical discussions regarding theological matters. A revered pillar of the Jewish world, Rabbi Moses ben Maimon also had a significant influence on some great medieval writers and thinkers, such as Baruch Spinoza and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, as well as an important impact on the medical science archives. Let us now continue with an excerpt from part 2, chapters 28 and 32, from Rabbi Moses ben Maimon's book, The Guide for the Perplexed. The Jewish philosopher reflects on more notable verses from the Hebrew Bible in support of the authority of God's will and His perfect doings. Chapter 28. The works of God being most perfect, admitting no addition or deduction, must remain the same forever. It is impossible that anything should exist that could cause a change in them. In the conclusion of the verse, Solomon, as it were, describes the purpose of exceptions from the laws of nature, or an excuse for changes in them, when he says, "And God doeth it," meaning he performs miracles that man should fear before him. The words which follow, "That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been, and God seeketh that which is pursued," contain the idea that God desires the perpetuity and continuity of the universe. The fact that the works of God are perfect, admitting of no addition or diminution, has already been mentioned by Moses, the wisest of all men, in the words, "He is the rock, his work is perfect." Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 14. All his works or creations are most perfect, containing no defect whatever, nothing superfluous, nor anything unnecessary. Also, whatever God decrees for those created things, and whatever He effects through them, is perfectly just, and is the result of His wisdom. Chapter 32. There are as many different opinions concerning prophecy as concerning the eternity or non-eternity of the universe. Those who assume the existence of God as proved may be divided into three classes, according to the view they take of the question whether the universe is eternal or not. Similarly, there are three different opinions on prophecy. 1. Among those who believe in prophecy, and even among our co-religionists, there are some ignorant people who think as follows. God selects any person He pleases, inspires him with the spirit of prophecy, and entrusts him with a mission. It makes no difference whether that person be wise or stupid, old or young, provided he be, to some extent, morally good. For these people have not yet gone so far as to maintain that. God might also inspire a wicked person with His spirit. They admit that this is impossible, unless God has previously caused him to improve his ways. 2. The philosophers hold that prophecy is a certain faculty of man in a state of perfection, which can only be obtained by study. Although the faculty is common to the whole race, yet it is not fully developed in each individual, either on account of the individual's defective constitution or on account of some other external cause. This is the case with every faculty common to a class. It is only brought to a state of perfection in some individuals and not in all. But it is impossible that it should not be perfect in some individual of the class. And if the perfection is of such a nature that it can only be produced by an agent, such an agent must exist. Accordingly, it is impossible that an ignorant person should be a prophet, or that a person being no prophet in the evening should, unexpectedly, on the following morning, find himself a prophet, as if prophecy were a thing that could be found unintentionally. But if a person, perfect in his intellectual and moral faculties, and also perfect, as far as possible, in his imaginative faculty, prepares himself in the manner which will be described, he must become a prophet, for prophecy is a natural faculty of man. It is impossible that a man who has the capacity for prophecy should prepare himself for it without attaining it, just as it is impossible that a person with a healthy constitution should be fed well and yet not properly assimilate his food, and the like. 3. The third view is that which is taught in Scripture and which forms one of the principles of our religion. It coincides with the opinion of the philosophers on all points except one. For we believe that even if one has the capacity for prophecy and has duly prepared himself, it may yet happen that he does not actually prophesy. It is in that case the will of God that withholds from him the use of the faculty. According to my opinion, this fact is as exceptional as any other miracle and acts in the same way. For the laws of nature demand that everyone should be a prophet who has a proper physical constitution and has been duly prepared as regards education and training. That preparation and perfection of moral and rational faculties are the sine qua non, the essential condition, our sages say exactly the same. The spirit of prophecy only rests upon persons who are wise, strong, and rich. The sons of the prophets were constantly engaged in preparation. That those who have prepared themselves may still be prevented from being prophets may be inferred from the history of Baruch, the son of Neriah. For he followed Jeremiah, who prepared and instructed him, and yet he hoped in vain for prophecy. I am weary with my sighing, and rest have I not found. He was then told through Jeremiah, Thus saith the Lord, Thus shalt thou say to him, Thou seekest for the great things, do not seek. Jeremiah chapter 45, verse 5. It may perhaps be assumed that prophecy is here described as a thing too great for Baruch. There are numerous passages in Scripture, as well as in the writings of our sages, which support the principle that it depends chiefly on the will of God, who is to prophesy and at what time, and that He only selects the best and the wisest. We hold that fools and ignorant people are unfit for this distinction. It is as impossible for any one of these to prophesy, for prophecy is impossible without study and training. When these have created the possibility, then it depends on the will of God whether the possibility is to be turned into reality. We must not be misled by the words of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verse 5. Before I formed thee in the womb, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth from the womb, I have sanctified thee. For this is the case with all prophets. There must be a physical preparation from the beginning of their existence. Nor must we be misled by prophecies like the following. I will pour out my spirit over all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Since it is distinctly stated what is meant by prophesy in this place, meaning your old men will dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. For we call also prophets all those who reveal something unknown by surmises or conjectures or correct inferences. Thus prophets of Baal and of Asherah are mentioned in Scripture. And God says, If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, etc. Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 1. As to the revelation on Mount Sinai, where Moses received the Ten Commandments, also the great fire, and heard the fearful thunderings that caused such an extraordinary terror. But only those of them who were duly qualified were prophetically inspired, each one according to his capacities. Therefore it is said, Come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu. Moses rose to the highest degree of prophecy, according to the words, and Moses alone shall come near the Lord. Aaron was below him, Nadab and Abihu below Aaron, and the 70 elders below Nadab and Abihu, and the rest below the latter, each one according to his degree of perfection. Similarly, our sages wrote, Moses had his own place, and Aaron his own. Righteous viewers, we thank you for your friendly company for today's words of wisdom. Coming up next is Eurovision, Europe Shine a Light, right after Noteworthy News. Please stay tuned to Supreme Master Television for more uplifting programming. May your spiritual path lead you to deeper love and wisdom. In God's grace.
Our programs offer many languages. Please visit suprememastertv.com/schedule and suprememastertv.com/WOW.